There is a Redeemer, Jesus, God's own Son. Precious Lamb of God, Messiah, Holy One. Thank you, O my Father, for giving us your Son and leaving your Spirit till your work on earth.
Good evening, everyone. We want to turn this evening to the book of 2 Kings, 2 Kings and chapter 5, and we take the time to read the first 14 verses, and we read from verse number 1 to 14. Now Naaman, captain of the host of the king of Syria, was a great man with his master, and honorable, because by him the Lord had given deliverance unto Syria. He also was a mighty man in valor, but he was a leper. And the Syrians had gone out by companies and had brought away captive out of the land of Israel a little maid, and she waited on Naaman's wife. And she said unto her mistress, Would God, my Lord, were with the prophet that is in Samaria, for he would recover him of his leprosy. And one went in and told his Lord, saying, Thus and thus saith the maid, that is of the land of Israel. The king of Syria said, Go, and I will send a letter unto the king of Israel. And he departed and took with him 10 talents of silver and 6,000 pieces of gold and 10 changes of raiment. And he brought the letter to the king of Israel, saying, Now, when this letter is come unto thee, behold, I have therewith sent Naaman my servant to thee, that thou mayest recover him of his leprosy. And it came to pass, when the king of Israel had read the letter, that he rent his clothes and said, Am I God to kill and to make alive, that this man doth send unto me to recover a man of his leprosy? Wherefore consider, I pray you, and see how he seeketh a quarrel against me. And it was so, when Elisha the man of God had heard that the king of Israel had rent his clothes, that he sent to the king, saying, Wherefore hast thou rent thy clothes? Let him come now to me, and he shall know that there is a prophet in Israel. Naaman came in his horses and with his chariot, and stood at the door of the house of Elisha. And Elisha sent a messenger unto him, saying, Go and wash in Jordan 7 times, and thy flesh shall come again to thee, and thou shalt be clean. But Naaman was wroth, and went away and said, Behold, I thought he would surely come out to me and stand and call on the name of the Lord his God and strike his hand over the place and recover the leprosy. Are not Abana and Pharpar, rivers of Damascus, better than all the waters of Israel? May I not wash in them and be clean? So he turned and went away in a rage. And his servants came near and spoke unto him and said, My father, if the prophet had bid thee do some great thing, wouldest thou not have done it? How much rather then, when he saith to thee, Wash and be clean? Then went he down and dipped himself 7 times in Jordan, according to the saying of the man of God. And his flesh came again like unto the flesh of a little child, and he was clean. And the Lord will bless his word to our hearts for his name's sake. Amen. Now, friends, we want to show you this evening from this passage, an Old Testament passage it is. But we want to show you, you know, that all the pomp and all the pride cannot cleanse you from sin. We have here one of the most pertinent types in scripture of sin, leprosy, a type of sin. And truly, I don't think there's anything ever in the scripture can show you clearer what sin is than leprosy. really an Old Testament type of it. Then we have here the pride of people. We have people like this today, you know, who look down with scorn and contempt upon the working out of salvation. They would think that the cross, oh, that bloody cross, you know, there must be some other way to have salvation. Now this man found out he had a rude awakening. He couldn't get it in all the clean rivers. He had to go down to the muddy Jordan, you know, to get it. And you cannot get it by any means, by that bloody cross at Calvary. No other way you can get salvation. There was no person else but the man of God. He couldn't get it otherwise than the man of God who introduced him to it. You can't get salvation otherwise from the Son of God. I am the way, the truth, and the life. And you can't get it from any other person. These are lessons to be learned. So we take this Old Testament passage and take these characters and take the issue and we bring it forward, and you will see clearly that you are on dangerous ground if you have this high, proud mind. And if you refuse to humble, like this man did at first, he refused. But then, I tell you, a friend. Did a friend invite you here this evening? Has a friend told you to listen to the gospel? That is truly your friend. This man not only had servants, you know, the servants were very friendly to him. They said, Master, if he had told you to do something great, you would have done it. If he had told you to pull your pocket, you would have. He told you to do that humble deed, go and do it. And we this evening, as God's messenger, you know, we're not telling you to climb Jacob's ladder now, you know. We're not telling you to try to monk up to Jerusalem. You know what we are telling you? Be humble and accept the person and work of the Lord Jesus Christ. And that is enough. That plus nothing. That will give you salvation. Now here the scene was this. Israel at this time very bad behavior, you know. Very, very. You know, the Lord had so much problems with them, you know. I think we said it last night. The Lord worked his miracles. He showed them clearly that he was in charge in Egypt. He got them out. Got them out by his mighty power very quickly in one night. But then, oh, the wrestle. Oh, the struggle to get Egypt out of them. You know, we have persons today the same way. They behave very, very badly. And all of consistently the Lord had to take his protective hand off them and allow the other nations to come and to make them subservient. This is one of these occasions, you know, Syria. Syria now had the upper hand. Syria sent in their forces and they raided them. And they took away the cream of the crop. Whether it was the young people or their finances, they looked at a man and said, look, you have two wives, give me all two. You know, that was the situation. That's how the Syrians did it. They really put them there, you know, on the back foot and marauded them. Such was the occasion here. And the man there here in that is featured, he was a Syrian. And he was an A-class soldier, the general, you know, of the king of Syria. Captain of the horse, star boy, we would call him. And everything was in his favor. Look here what is said concerning Mr. Naaman. His name means pleasantness, but he might have been far from that. Mr. Naaman, captain of the horse of the king of Syria, the king's right-hand man. Who wouldn't want a man like that, you know, to send out? David had a man like that called Joab. Called Joab, you know, he was a terrible fellow, you know. But David had a man, he could really trust him on the battlefield. He couldn't trust him otherwise. But on the battlefield, that Mr. Joab. And so here is the king of Syria, having a man like this. There, you would want it. And your army general, you know, captain, that man. And all is said about him, look, a great man. That's who he was. Great because of his feats before he had done. Yeah, there he would gone out to battle and probably never lost one. Never lost one. So he was great. He was great. And next thing about him, you know, honorable. Oh, they had decorated him. No doubt. You know, we decorate some persons because, rightly so, they have been good to our societies and all that. And all that. But sometimes, you know, that there puts some people really high, aloof, and think themselves now because of their greatness on the battlefield, or their greatness or their expertise here or there, whether it's in sport, or whether they help to build the economy, whatever they have done. But that, you know, puts some people there, make them think now that they have made themselves. It makes them think so. We want to stick a pin there for a minute, friend. Let me tell you, if you are great in the eyes of society, and if the country have done, rewarded you for your feats and all that, very, very good. If they tell me that I have to call you sir, oh yes, with the greatest pleasure I'll do that. With the greatest pleasure I will do that. Because you have served your country very, very well. But have you served the Lord? Have you served the Lord? But you think again. There is something there, you know, and this pumps this man up. But the passage tells us, you know, there is something hidden in there that neither the country can take away or this man. He was, this is what it said, he also was a mighty man of valor. In other words, anybody would have wanted, you know, they would have stolen him from this series. A mighty man. When you see him, the battle is won already. Even by his name. You know, I had the privilege of walking out on a cricket field with Mr. Sir Garfield Sobers. It made me feel that I was so big. I was the wicket keeper, you know, and he walked out there. And I was in the team. It's a Garfield Sobers. And he had some conversation with us. He said he believed this, you know. When some persons were running up to bowl at him, they were frightened, you know. They were scared. Not him. He was batting. They had the ball. But they were frightened. He told me that. Well, when you hear about Mr. Naaman, people start to get frightened. Mighty man of valor. Well, listen, friend, as mighty as you might be, as much fame and acclaim, hold on to it. Nobody tell you, enjoy it, whatever it is. But listen to this part. But he was a leper. Now, this is some of the saddest words you will find in the scriptures, you know. But he was a leper. Why are they so sad? Well, you don't see any cure at all for leprosy, you know. Even now, medical science haven't found a cure for it. You know, I had the privilege of seeing a leper. I saw him because there was a place in the island where I live, where they had them separated by themselves in quarantine. And I had to visit there on my job, and I saw one. Not a very good sight. And he was not the worst I've heard about. And the scriptures would tell you that this leprosy was very bad for the way they had to be isolated and all that. And you know, you follow the scriptures. The only cure was from God. It is only God in the scriptures who cured leprosy. He would tell you, go to the priest. Give him what you have to give him to show all the offering and all that. The Lord told him that only the Lord Jesus in the New Testament there in Luke. That pure leprosy, no medical, even now medical science, that the Lord had withdrawn it in a certain way. Yes, there are things now that you would have probably contributed to it. Cleanliness and so on now might be in the air, and we don't see them. See, no, no cure. And I want to tell you something, friend. Thank God for raising you up. Thank God that you put your energies and so on. Thank God for the country, but you're a sinner. Leprosy is a type of sin. Dreaded leprosy, dreaded sin. You are a sinner. And let me tell you, all the fame and acclaim in the world, a medical science can't touch sin. You are a sinner. And we don't have to wonder, we don't have to really bite our tongues when we tell you that. You know why? It isn't because, and we say this over and over, it isn't because you were so bad behaved as a child. It isn't because you were a bandit. Nothing. It isn't because you failed to go to school or you failed to get married. It isn't any of those things. If it was one of them, you could correct it. It is because of who you are, not what you have done. Who you are a sinner. And that goes way back from the moment You know, sin entered the universe because of Lucifer. And he wanted there in pride. Pride, again, you see pride in this part. Pride, I will ascend, I will do this. Sin entered the universe. Sin entered the world of humanity there in the Garden of Eden. There, when he tripped that woman up, he tripped her up. Then she influenced her husband, who had the direct, the command from God. Genesis 2:17, the day you eat of the tree, of the fruit of the tree, of the knowledge of good and evil, you will die. You will die. And so on he went. And when the woman saw the ear gate, she had heard him already, the hand gate, she touched, and so on. And then they had to use the foot, the walk, died from God. And so all of that, every sense went into it. Now let me tell you this, you don't have to do anything to be a sinner. It was already in your genes. Every human being born in this world, from descending from Adam, a sinner because you have inherited the genes. The only person came by natural human birth and had not inherited the genes of Adam is the Lord Jesus Christ, because he was conceived by the Holy Ghost. So you see, you are a sinner. So these sad words there in type apply to you. But he was a sinner. And speak to your heart, speak to your conscience now and say this, I am a sinner. I am a sinner. Just tell yourself that, unbeliever friend. Now this man thought, he probably had never had a thought about it before. Never had a thought about it. And how there did he get to be introduced? A humble maid. Some are looking for people from above to come down to them. You know, some don't want to hear you. I remember being in conversation, and they would always refer to gatherings like this as wayside. You know why? Because we weren't colored up. And because we hadn't gone to the schools of early learning, that was said about the Lord Jesus. How come this man have such knowledge and not learn? Not rabbinically taught, you know? When they saw Acts chapter 4, the apostles, they were unlearned and ignorant men because they didn't go to rabbinical school. But I tell you, they had the apostolic power that the high priest didn't have. And so when we preach the gospel to you, it is not ourselves that we are presenting to you. It's the Lord Jesus Christ. Our background might be lowly. But I tell you, had not for this lowly maid, this man would never have been introduced. And let me tell you this. This is a very, very touching tale here, very touching story. If you look at this maid, she didn't learn this in Syria. She was a captive, pulled up out of her. She had what we would call today a culture shock. Pulled up out of her own environment from her parents' house. Ripped up just like Daniel and all those. He to Babylon, she to Syria. And off they carry her as a captive. And now she have to wait on Naaman's wife. Whatever it is. But you know what? She didn't forget the power of God she saw in the prophets in Samaria. It was taught to her. Probably a young damsel she was. But it was taught. Parents, teach your children about Christ. Proverbs 22, verse number 6. Train up a child in the way he should go. And when he's old, you will not depart from it. As I tell you, she had that training. She had that training. She knew that leprosy, you know, of all that man there, but the king would have spent anything on him. Dollars and dollars would have been spent on him. But they couldn't. All the advice that king would have been able, you will see a little later, how he, in the embassy, what he did. He didn't send them to anybody. Lord, he sent to another king. And if it was available anywhere at all in the world, that king would have sent to get medical attention for that right hand, for his right hand man. But I tell you, that little maid, let us turn another side. There are persons today, they want all the philosophical teachings in the world. Yes, nothing wrong with philosophy, nothing wrong with schools of higher learning. But some people think that that's it. And when you introduce them to the scriptures that are made simple, oh, they scoff at them. But you want to see the power in this? You want to see this? That from a child thou hast known the holy scriptures that are able to make you wise unto salvation. That's the power in this. So people want all the things that they can look up and reach out to and carry a big name and acclaim and forget the little things. The little maid and this little book. 66 books the Lord have allowed the Holy Spirit to move persons to scribe. Pay attention to the little things. Pay attention. Yes, you want to pay attention to the great things, the great aspirations that you have. And I said, nothing entirely wrong with those. You're a young person, you want to achieve. You want to be reasonably independent. So you want to work for yourself and don't depend on hands up. You want your morals to be intact. Yes, you don't mind if you make some dollars, hold on to your dollars, spend it, make it. You have the opportunity to make some money, I tell you. But you are a sinner, and all the money cannot get rid of it. Pay some attention to the word of God. Simple as it may seem to you, there is a lesson there. There's a message. And this man learned that. What to God that my master there, if he was in Samaria, or the man of God I left there, the man of God that I know about, would do something about that leprosy that all of his fame and acclaim can't do. She had the knowledge. God speaks in mysterious ways. If you only look to see how the Lord speaks, especially the Old Testament, there with it. Look at the man Joseph. Look at Daniel. Look at Daniel and so on in Babylon. And look at the Lord's mouthpiece here and there. And look at the skies and you see him. Look in the scriptures, you see him. He's still speaking. But people want to hear him today speaking and rolling back the clouds and all this. But he has spoken right here. He speaks in simple ways. He wants you to listen and pay attention to that. But thank God, you know, when a man wants healing, he wants it. And never mind, it's a little maid. He paid some attention. Under normal circumstances, he probably would never have wanted to hear that maid, you know. But he paid some attention. And the king now, anxious, the king wanted that his right-hand man, you know. I would like that man fit. But if a war break out now, who am I going to depend on? Because he had to be isolated in some way. They had to keep him now in cotton. And the king sent right away. But I want to show you, you know, you have good intentions. You can send to the wrong people. He sent to the king. Well, we would expect something like that. You know why he was sent to the other king? He sent to King Jehoram. And the king said, look, I give you a letter and I give you money. You got verse number 5 and verse number 6, you see that. He gave him a lot of money, silver and gold. Silver and gold cannot get rid of sin. What Peter said? Silver and gold have I not? Because silver and gold cannot get rid of sin. They sing in one hymn, the believers, they think you got it all. Nor silver nor gold can obtain my redemption. Can't, not at all. But he sent him. As we expect that he would give him some money. But then, not only what he sent with him, look, verse 6, and he brought the letter to the king of Israel. Wrong man. Yes, we would expect because of his ambassador level or so on, sovereign level, he would do that. Wrong person. The king can't help you. You got to come down. Some people want salvation handed to them through the window or up on the high loft. You've got to come down. And he would see that. You can't get it up there, it must come down. It tells us there in Matthew chapter 18, except you humble yourself and become as a little child. Whenever you see salvation appears in the gospel, you know, it is coming down. Zacchaeus ran up to meet the Lord. He's short. He looked, the Lord said, come down. Salvation, you come down. I am going to buy the house. Salvation, come to your house.
Thank you for viewing today's broadcast, Moments with Truth. We want to invite you to call us at 796-0979 or 283-2222. Or you can email us at afrod64@gmail.com. If you look on the screen, you will see our various locations and the times of our services. Be free to attend. Welcome to the Seattle Podcast.
And leaving your spirit.
Is done.